Family, greetings in the wonderful and precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We trust that you're well and blessed. This morning, we are so excited. We know that next week, Sunday, we launch our Sunday morning service in Johannesburg. And if you are in the Johannesburg area and you're looking for a church, you're welcome to connect with us. Send us an email, contact us on the cell number that will appear on the screen, and you can join our Joburg branch. Can you close your eyes and bow your hearts as we ready ourselves to receive God's word? Let us pray. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, as we bow in your presence, we thank you so much for your great wisdom, your great love. We thank you, Father, for all that you've done for us through your Son, Jesus Christ, to ensure that we can receive the fullness of that which you have. Now, Lord, as we come around your word for a few moments, we pray, Jesus, that you would give us understanding, you would enlighten our hearts. Father, build and stir our passion within us and give us, Lord, the courage to, Father, fulfill the destiny that you've called us to fulfill. I bless now your word, and I thank you, Father, that your word will continue to challenge us in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, good morning, family. We have, for the year 2021, we sense that God has given us a theme, Living in Eden, and we've now, for 4 months, been teaching on the subject of living in Eden, and we've come to the end of the first phase of our teaching. We want to go into the next phase, and for the next season, we want to deal with spiritual warfare. Now, when you begin to study Eden before the fall, very interesting, the Bible teaches in Genesis 2 verse 15, it says there, and the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to tend and guard and keep it. Very interesting that even before the fall, Adam was given the responsibility to guard or protect the garden. And you see, family, Adam had the key responsibility of protecting the grace, protecting the anointing, and protecting the authority that God had placed upon him in the Garden of Eden. We know and we understand the fall took place, but Jesus has come. And Jesus has totally restored us to where Adam was before the fall. And so we know that everything that we need to become all that God would have us be, God has already given it to us. However, like Adam before the fall, we also are responsible for guarding or protecting that which God has given us. And so how do we guard and how do we protect that which God has given us? It's called spiritual warfare, and we are going to have to get involved in spiritual warfare. And so for this next season, our subtitle that we're going to focus on under the banner of Living in Eden is spiritual warfare, and we're going to begin to look at it and develop it over a season so that we could then exercise it effectively, spiritual warfare, so that not only do we get what God has for us, but also that we stop the attacks of the enemy from penetrating and from overcoming us in Jesus' name. And so let's start this morning, as we introduce it this morning, go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, reading verses 4 and 5. It reads there, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God, for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ." I want to read this verse, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, but I want to read verse 3 and 4 in the Passion Translation. It reads, "Although we live in the natural realm, we don't wage a military campaign employing human weapons, using manipulation to achieve our aims. Instead, our spiritual weapons are energized with divine power to effectively dismantle the defenses behind which people hide." And so, yeah, we see clearly here that we don't use manipulation as a tool to overcome. We don't hide behind manipulators, but we understand that our fight is not flesh and blood. It's not manipulators. Our fight is a spiritual warfare. And God has given us spiritual weapons that if we know how to use them effectively, we will get the outcomes that God has for us in Jesus' name. So let's start right in the beginning and ask the question, what is the purpose, or rather, what is spiritual warfare? What is spiritual warfare? We must understand that there is a very real, unseen world that is out there. And if we're not aware of the spiritual world, where there is a war between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of the devil, the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness, we have to be aware that there is a war that is raging. And if we are not equipped spiritually to engage in warfare, we will never get the outcomes that God has. And so it will almost be as though we will take two steps forward and three steps back. Amen. And so we cannot afford to live like that. We have to see consistency. We have to see stability. We have to see that God will continually cause us to move forward from day to day, from week to week, from month to month, and from year to year. And so when you look in the Bible in Ephesians, it begins to give us an understanding of what spiritual warfare is. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, it says, "Your hand-to-hand combat is not with human beings, but with the highest principalities and authorities operating in rebellion under the heavenly realm. For they are a powerful class of demon gods and evil spirits that hold this dark world in bondage." And so we see here that there is a spiritual battle that's taking place, and we have to be aware of the spiritual battle. This battle takes place every single day. And so, meaning that we cannot allow our guards to be dropped at any point in time. We also have to understand that we are equipped by God Himself, that we can overcome the devil. And if you look at what the Bible says, it's the highest principalities. It's a powerful class of demon gods. And so this is not just any level of demonic activity. These are the highest powers. These are demon gods that the enemy sends for you, and especially for those who are serious about the kingdom of God and for those who want to establish the rule of God on the earth. And so we see very clearly here that God now, we understand what this warfare is. It's about the enemy. It's about demon gods. It's about the highest principalities. But if there's one thing that we must know is that we are equipped to overcome. So let's start by asking the question, what is the purpose for spiritual warfare? Why must I get involved in spiritual warfare? And the first reason why we have to get involved in spiritual warfare, number one, is that so that we can release the love nature of God in our hearts. So that we can release the love nature of God in our hearts. Go with me to Romans chapter 8, reading verses 37. It reads, "Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing. And here's the key, shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so you see here, there are so many different elements here. He speaks about life, death, angels, principalities, height, present, past. There are so many dynamics. And these attacks that the devil uses, it's for the purpose of separating us from the love of God. Go with me to Colossians 1 verse 13. It reads there, he has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. Can you see there? In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. And so God has conveyed us into the Son of his love. And so what is the Son of his love? Why is this so important? Why will this help us overcome? And why must we be involved in spiritual warfare? Because where purpose is not known, abuse is inevitable. And so we are warring, number one, family. This is the purpose, so that we can receive the nature of God. Because when you begin to look at what is the love of God, the Bible teaches in 1 John 4 verse 8, he who does not love does not know God, for God is love. And so this battle that we faced with 24/7 is so that we can access and allow to manifest within us the love nature of God. How amazing is that? Because you see, family, the Bible is clear. It says, as he is, so are we in this world. Meaning that we have the potential to operate like God. And how do we operate like God? When we allow the nature of God, the love nature of God, not only to be in us, but to manifest through us. And so the devil knows that if that love nature can manifest through our lives, then we will become like God, where we will rule and reign. We will manifest Genesis 1, 28, where we will be fruitful, we will multiply, we will replenish, we will subdue, and we will have dominion on the earth according to our mandate. And so he understands that if I can challenge, if I can fight, if I can destroy every Christian from allowing the love nature of God to manifest, I know that they will be defeated. And so he does everything in his power to rob us from this love nature. And so, family, the only way we can overcome is that if we are involved in spiritual warfare, and if we are persistent, that we will not allow circumstances, people, opportunities to rob us from allowing the nature of God to manifest in our lives. The second purpose why spiritual warfare is so important is because not only for the love nature to manifest, but we have to be involved in constant warfare so that we can allow the kingdom of God to be established on the earth. That is our mandate. God placed us on the earth, and our responsibility is to heavenize the earth, or to Edenize the earth, so that the nature of God, which is the love nature, can be manifested throughout the earth. Look at the Bible says in Revelation chapter 11, verses 15, it says there, then the seventh angel sounded, and there was loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And so we see a family that God's desire is so that the kingdom of this world will become the kingdoms of our God, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, he will reign forever and ever. And so that is the purpose of spiritual warfare, so that we can begin or continually expand and extend the kingdom. And so how do you expand the kingdom? How do you extend the kingdom? Go with me to Luke 17 verse 20. It reads, now when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God does not come with observation, nor will they say, see here or see there. For indeed, the kingdom of God is within you. You see, family, that's why the nature, love nature of God, if it's stifled, and if you don't know how to war off, get involved in spiritual warfare and overcome the enemy, Not only will the love nature of God never manifest in you, but you will never be able to establish the kingdom of God. So you see, we are responsible. We are responsible, number one, for getting involved in warfare so that we can overcome the attacks of the devil, so that the nature of God will never be stifled or hindered. And the purpose for that nature growing and developing and manifesting through us is that through that God nature, we will have dominion. And dominion mandate will allow us to extend and establish the kingdom of God like never before. And so I want us this morning to begin to, I want us to look at this morning's teaching through the lens of natural warfare. Because the spiritual and the natural, they run parallel. And so if we can understand dynamics in the natural, it will give us an understanding of how it works in the realm of the spirit. So when you look at natural wars throughout history, you begin to see that there are three key components to warfare. The first component, number one, we understand is weapons. The Bible says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. And so God has equipped us with weapons. In the natural, if a country is going into war, one of the first things they assess is that they assess their weapons to see, you know, where they stand, if they have the fighting power to engage in war. The second thing that they look at is skill. The Bible says we must rightly, skillfully divide the word of truth. The Bible teaches that Abram had 318 trained men in his home. And so skill speaks of those soldiers that are trained and equipped, that are efficient in handling those weapons. And then the third level of warfare is strategy. And you find that when a country goes into war, they'll always have a war room. And a war room is a place where the greatly skilled generals will meet and will discuss strategy. And so those three components are so important: weapons, skill, and strategy. Now, the challenges that present itself is this, is that if you have men that are highly skilled, and if you have enough weapons, but if you don't have a key strategy, even though you have a bigger army, you have better weapons, but if you don't have a key strategy, a smaller army can defeat you. Or maybe you might have some brilliant minds that can bring about significant strategy. But if you don't have skilled men that can handle the weapons, you might still lose. And so what I want you to see here is that all three work together. Weapons, skill, and strategy. And so when we look at it spiritually, if we want to overcome, we're going to have to understand what our weapons are. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Skill. The Bible says that we must be trained in the word of righteousness. We must be skilled in the word of righteousness. We need to have proper understanding. And then three, strategy. You know, when you look at David was trained in both distant combat fighting and close term or close person combat fighting. And when he sussed out Goliath, he knew that Goliath was only trained in close combat fighting. He knew that Goliath's strength was his sword. And so David knew that putting on Saul's armor, as wonderful as it was, but putting on that armor was not the strategy to overcome the devil. David knew that maybe when he killed the bear, it was close combat. When he killed the lion, but he knew that if I go and face Goliath with close combat in close combat battle, I'll definitely be defeated. And so we knew that here I need to operate with distant combat. So there was either an option of a bow and arrow or his sling. Now we know that David was highly skilled with his sling. And so because he understood strategy, he was able to overcome the devil. So spiritually, family, it is the same. We need to understand our weapons. We need to have skill, but we also need godly strategy. And if we don't have these three, we will never get the outcomes that God has. And so now that we have that in place, because that's what we want to deal with over the next season, we want to deal with how can I not only understand the weapons that are given to me spiritually, but how do I operate them? Number two, we want to understand how can I be skilled in the word of righteousness? And then number three, how can I formulate strategies that will give me or yield the significant outcomes? I want to draw this to a close this morning. And I want to just draw your attention to, you know, even before we go into battle, one of the challenges that we have, and these are even, for example, armies that are well-stocked with weaponry, armies that have their soldiers trained and skilled, armies that have a leadership that is fully brilliant. One of the challenges that we have, even with all these working, weaponry, skill, and strategist, what the enemies would generally do is that they will look at putting spies within that country. They will put insurgents in there. They will try to tap in to the communication lines so that they can get intel, get information about the strategy of that army. Now, the devil does the exact same thing. The devil, his desire is that if he can hack into your information, if he can tap into it, whether it's leaked or whether it's intercepted, just like a natural army, if the devil or if the enemy can tap into that information, no matter how great your army is, no matter how skilled your soldiers are, no matter how brilliant your strategists are, if the enemy knows your strategy, he will ambush you and he will take you out. And history has proven that time and time again, where we've seen some brilliant armies with significant manpower and significant weapons, but we've seen because of leaked information or because of spies being planted, we've seen how that they have been totally defeated. And so before we even go into dealing with this, the very first thing I want to deal with is that we have to understand that the enemy spiritually operates exactly the same. So what do you mean? When you look at a war scenario, there's two levels. There's the masses, which are the soldiers, and then there is the war room, which are the strategist. The enemy will plant spies among the soldiers and will also try to get a spy into the war room, because that's key. If you can get into the war room where the strategy is formulated, I can assure you they'll defeat. So when you deal with men in the war room, these brilliant men, they're so wise. They understand that there are enemies among the soldiers, spies. So at times, because of their brilliance, they'll even intentionally release false information so that it can go back to the enemy and they can overcome. However, sometimes some of the information that is transferred is true and that information is passed down. Now, there's two levels there. And so the first level, family, from a spiritual perspective, is that the Bible calls this sins of the flesh. And I want to encourage you, sins of the flesh are are not as detrimental as other sins, but it robs you, slows you down, and sometimes even destroys your destiny. And so the first thing I want to encourage, before you begin to understand the weapons of your warfare, before you begin to understand and become skilled in the word of righteousness, before you can even begin to get strategy from God, we have to put first things first. You have to deal with the appetites of the flesh, and we have to overcome these appetites. And so this morning as we start, our first warfare is to overcome the appetites of the flesh. And I want to encourage you, family, God will give you grace and strength to overcome the appetites. And as you overcome the appetites, you'll be amazed how God will set you free. And you can begin to start warring for your destiny to fulfill and become all that God would have you be. The second level, and I close with this, is that not only are there sins of the flesh, but when you study the Bible, very interesting, you find that there are sins against authority. Now, sins against authority are dealt with on a much more harshly than sins of the flesh. In fact, when I study the Old Testament, I cannot find one person that sinned against the flesh, that sinned against authority and fulfilled their destiny. And so the next level, before you even begin to skill yourself in worship, before you even begin to, in weapons, before you even begin to skill yourself and have the right skill and have the right strategy, you're going to have to deal with sins against authority. And sins against authority, when you begin to take leaders and pastors for granted and speak about them like how you speak about your friends and your family, and you bring them down to your level, I can assure you one thing. The Bible says, touch not the anointed and do my prophets no harm. When you equalize, you neutralize. Because you begin to familiarize yourself with leaders. You're going to have to understand, family, that there's rank and there's order in the kingdom. And that's why if a spy can get into the war room, no matter how brilliant, no matter how equipped, no matter how skilled an army is, if that information leaks out, that army will be destroyed. No matter how brilliant you are, no matter how talented you are. Remember what the Bible says. The Bible says clearly that your giftings are without repentance. Meaning this, that God will protect his people, that you can preach and the anointing can flow. You can sing and the anointing can flow. But if you're not in alignment, you will never get the outcomes. And so I close with this thought. God is omniscient. He's all-knowing. He's in control. There are some circumstances that he allows because he wants to see what's in your heart. And because he allows his circumstances, he wants to monitor your responses. And when you don't respond correctly, you disqualify yourself. So, Pastor, how do we deal with it? Two things. Number one, I always embrace the Joseph response. How did Joseph respond? When Joseph was faced where he could violate authority on the highest level, sleep with Potiphar's wife, what did Joseph do? Joseph ran. So when you're faced with people that are offended, people that are disgruntled, people that have challenges with your leader, your pastor, family, you know they say nice people finish last. Stop being nice to people that are unjust. Stop being nice to people that are offended. Stop being nice to people that have a problem with God's elect. Because if you want to accommodate those who have a problem with God's elect, that which is on you, that which is on them will come on you, and you too won't get the outcomes. And so when you examine your life, you're such a nice person, but where's the fruit? You're such a nice person, but where's the breakthrough? All that you do is you, and all that you've earned is by the sweat of your brow. Because you must understand that when you deal with sins of authority, you cut yourself off from the grace and you cut yourself off from the blessing of God. And so the second thing that we need to do is we need to run from people, one. And number two, we need to run to God. Because sometimes God will allow a situation, even amongst your own leaders, because you want to see what's in your heart. And if you run to God, God will strengthen you. You will pass the test. And I can guarantee you, God will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out some significant blessings. So what we're dealing with is for mature Christians. And if you're ready to go into warfare, if you want to receive your weapons, if you want to be skilled in the word of righteousness, and if you want a strategy from the wisdom of God to become all that God would have you be, we're going to have to put first things first. We have to overcome sins of the flesh, and we have to overcome sins against authority. And when we do that, then we are ready to be trained in the word of righteousness. So I trust that you are blessed. We're just introducing this morning, and we will continue for the next few weeks as we develop this teaching and the series on spiritual warfare. Close your eyes and bow your hearts this morning and allow me to pray. Father, as I stretch forth my hands, I thank you, Lord, for all those that are dealing with sins against the flesh. Father, whatever the weaknesses are, I pray that Holy Spirit, your grace and your mercy will manifest significantly in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray for those that are dealing with sins against authority. Father, I pray that, Lord, there will be true repentance, Father God. And true repentance means, Father, separating and moving in a new direction. I pray over their lives that, Father, they'll not try to be nice to accommodate people, but, Lord, they'll understand the significance that they only have one life to live, and they'll make that change, make that decision, restore that relationship, and move forward significantly in Jesus' name. I pray, Father God, your choice blessings now in the name of the Father and the Son and the precious Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Come on, I just want you, I just want you. Just want. I just want you, I just want you.
Just want.
I just want you, I just want you.
Just want.